Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. No choice but to get it on. Welcome to the podcast, Kenny Kenji Gallo. Kenny is author of a new book called The Breakout. I don't have it in front of me. I know there's a...
Breakshot.
That's why I really don't have it in front of me. I interviewed Kenny when I did Loveline about 3 weeks ago.
3 weeks ago.
A month ago. Found him fascinating, so told him he should come on our little podcast, and we can really get into it on this because there's no FCC, and we have a nice long format, so we can really get into your story. Give us a little nutshell. We'll get everyone caught up on what you do, what the book's about, what you did, I should say, and then we'll get into some details.
Okay. Well, I wrote Breakshot. It's about my life in the mafia and, you know, traditional organized crime. Started off as a cocaine dealer in the 80s down in Orange County, and it grew. And then I moved into like just regular organized crime stuff and pornography, like the adult business. Made lots of films, you know, ran sports books, that kind of thing.
And I was talking to you on Loveline about the current status of the mafia, not what it was.
No, the current status today is it's basically, and like a lot of people might get mad for me saying this, it's kind of like, they're kind of like street gangs now. I mean, I was with one of the big five families, the Colombo family, and a lot of people like to portray that they're in the mafia, but they're not, and it's really just a few hardcore guys. You have to remember there's a huge Italian-American population, and only a tiny percentage of those guys are even involved in that, and then, and of the people that I even was with and I was bad with, they're only a tiny percentage of those people.
Right.
So there's a lot of good...
Has the government broken up the mafia, or is everyone's sort of me first mentality broken up the mafia? Because I have this theory. It's loosely based on riding motorcycles, where when I used to ride a motorcycle, if I was cutting through the lanes in traffic on the freeway and one of the cars swerved out a little to give me a little extra room, I'd give them the low hand wave. Acknowledge what you did. I saw you, saw me. And I give you that. And then when I drove, because I used to ride a motorcycle, I guess I was always conscientious of motorcycle riders. It's that kind of thing, like when you have a kid with Down syndrome, you know about the you're more aware of Down syndrome and other kids, other parents that have kids with Down syndrome. Like that with riding motorcycles. If you rode, you feel sorry for these guys. You know who they are. You see them coming in your rear view. And I swing out wide. And 10 years ago, 9 out of 10 guys would have given me the wave. They give me the thanks for the effort, buddy. Now, the last 100 times I've done it, no wave. 20 years from now, we're going to get fuck you, I'm sure. But it made me realize, I know it doesn't sound like much of an experiment, but what we're into is every man for themselves, and the mafia is about the family. And I'm just wondering if modern surveillance techniques and all that kind of stuff mixed with this sort of I'm in it for myself mentality has screwed up the mafia.
Well, yeah, for one, the government did crack down with their RICO Act, the Racketeer Influenced Corrupt Organization Act. They just attack you and they give you like 100 years and they take all your property.
Right.
And then they're increased their electronic surveillance. You can't beat it. And they have the get out of jail free card. They can put guys in the witness protection program. But then also, you're right, it's the whole changing of America. It's not just the mafia. It's the whole America. Nobody wants to be an Indian. Everybody wants to be a chief.
Right.
And they want to be a baller. Like really rich one day. They don't
want to win. And when you were in the mafia 20 years ago, there was a hierarchy. People knew their jobs. There was the foot soldiers and the dons, and you knew who you were.
Yeah, today everyone just wants to go bypass everything else and go straight to the top. Even I kind of worked, just like when you worked as a carpenter, you work as an apprentice first. You learn how to do things. You learn how to build the frame. You learn how to do one thing at a time. I learned from the ground floor up. A lot of these young guys, even guys that are my age, never were around old timers, so they just believe already that they know everything.
Well, how did it work? Where did the cocaine come from, and then how did you get it into this country?
The cocaine, it originated in Peru and in Bolivia, and then they moved into Colombia, and then from Colombia they shipped it to... At first, they were shipping it into Florida, and then as the South Florida route got too hot, then they started using Mexico. And then that's why all the Colombians shifted from Miami, Florida, to Southern California. And they came to Orange County, where I happen to grow up.
Which is 80 miles from there, maybe 60 miles from the Mexican border, right?
Correct.
At least Tijuana border. Did it come in across that border?
A little bit. They drove in trucks, and a lot they just flew in. Mm-hmm. They just, you know, use small Cessna planes, and they land at either in a field or in small airports.
And what could they do about it back then? I mean, or if anything?
Well, really, they weren't even equipped, the DEA or the FBI. They were playing catch-up. They weren't even equipped to deal with this. I mean, a big bus in Orange County was like a couple ounces of blow at one point in the 80s, and then it just, like, exploded.
When was the cocaine explosion? I mean, I know it's been around since, it's been around for, I don't know, since the 20s or the 30s, I guess. But, I mean, it really got popular early 80s, mid. I mean, if you were to pick one year, I guess I would say like 85 or 86. If I say this would be the zenith of the cocaine years, would that be about right?
Yeah, I would say like 85, 86 to 89, and that was it, pretty much.
And then why was that it? I mean, was it Len Bias having a heart attack after he signed a big contract for the Celtics, or like what? What do you think really put an end to the whole cocaine thing?
I just think that, they flooded the country with it, so it became plentiful and it was easy to get, and then everyone could afford it. And it wasn't so chic and everything else, and everyone just got burned out on it. Just, you could only spend so many nights staying up watching the sun come up when you come home from a club.
Right. And coke, like I said, I've lamented many times, when I was making $7 an hour for digging ditches, it was $125, $130 bucks a gram. And then later on, when I got thousands of dollars an hour for doing fucking nothing, just complaining on the radio, it got down to like 20 bucks a gram or something. And it always pissed me off. Now that I'm rich, cocaine is practically free, but I could remember in like 85, somebody would get a little bindle with a gram in it, or half a gram or a quarter gram, and people were just like, it was like when you throw a couple of breadcrumbs out and 80 pigeons all land on the same heel of bread. One time, Donnie, didn't we give Ray some baking soda or salt or something just to fuck with him or get him off our back or something? I never would buy this stuff because, like I said, I was literally making $7 an hour digging ditches, and it wasn't even under the table. Then taxes were coming out. And the idea that I would take me a day and a half to earn just what would be just a little pinch of this white powder seemed unbelievable. And, of course, I wasn't a hot chick. I could give a hell of a blowjob, but I wasn't hot, you know. But so there was really no place, and all my friends were poor too, so there was really nothing we could do about it. But once in a while, someone would get hold of some blow. And I'll tell you, the good coke, like the stuff that didn't have a bunch of speed in it, like it was pure and everything, it was kind of yummy. Like, I remember going, yeah, I know what people are talking about. Made you feel good.
Yeah, just made you feel aerobic.
But you never got into it.
No, I do it once in a while. I never really drank that much, and I didn't do blow that much. Every once, maybe once a month at the most.
You just didn't have that gene.
No, I don't have it. Like, I don't even have the drinking gene. I'm just not addictive to anything.
But you do have the thrill-seeking gene.
Yes,
which is weird, because normally the thrill-seeking gene is the cocaine or drug or booze gene.
Yeah, but I just have a different way. Like, I love to push the envelope. Like, I love to do MMA and spar, because I like to see, I just want to see if the guy, if a pro fighter or somebody could actually hurt me.
Right.
I like that challenge.
Right.
Yeah.
So you have the thrill seeking gene, but not the drug using gene, yeah. Which is good. Unless you jump off a building and the chute doesn't open, or the guy miscalculates the bungee cord, puts a little extra on it for you. So, all right. So now you're in Orange County.
Yes.
And you're getting the coke, and what's your job?
When I first started, I was just, you know, I was a real young kid. I would just transport it mostly. Mm-hmm. Before I couldn't drive, I would just take a bus and put in a backpack.
Really?
And, kilos. And I didn't have a car. I could bum a ride from someone else. And then as I got older and I got a car and I got a motorcycle, I would transport it. We had secret compartments, and I would transport it from like Orange County to San Francisco to Texas. I started to fly on planes too.
What's a good secret compartment for a car?
Well, we had one that was Suburban, and it was built into the side panels, and you had to, at the time you had to put the key in, put the car in neutral, and then press a button on the radio to do it, and it would pop open.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then that would open it, and then it was in there, and that would hold, that hold about 25 kilos, I think, of coke in both sides.
And a kilo, 2.3 pounds?
2.2 pounds, 1,000 grams.
1,000 grams. So at that point, 1 kilo is worth 10 grand? Oh, is that 100 grand? No, where the hell am I?
Back in the 80s, at that point, on the street value of coke was between like $30,000 and $40,000.
For a kilo?
For a kilo, on the street.
Like, so, on the street. So, yeah. So when you're transporting 25 kilos, the hell is that? Is that $200,000?
Yeah, it's, no.
Oh, no, it's $2 million?
Yeah.
So you're driving around with $2 million worth of coke in your Suburban?
Yeah, I got paid $3,000 per one to move them.
Would have been nice if you just got 1%. So did you ever have thought about taking the Suburban to Mexico or something like that?
You know what? I was like a real believer back then and like the whole organization and the group, and I was kind of like, you know, scared. I mean, I had not just the kilos, but I used to have millions of dollars in my control, and I would just turn it in.
So you'd go to San Francisco, drop it off, get millions of dollars, and bring it back?
Sometimes I would get money. Sometimes I wouldn't. Sometimes I would just drop it off in a house. I would never even meet somebody. They would just give me a key before I left, and I would just go put it inside the closet in someone's in some place.
Was there ever a situation where you had a large amount of cocaine or money that you knew no one else knew about?
There's someone always knows about the money. That when it comes in, when you're that high up and you're dealing with that, there's someone always knows.
And how would the drug cartels launder their money back then?
Well, at first, before it really exploded, they would do stuff like smurfing, where that's where you go out and you buy a bunch of cashier's checks or money orders lower than 10,000, and that, not like on TV where they go like 9,999, you get like 2,000, you know, and get a whole bunch and open up a business and then put it all in there. Then they would have businesses like bars and laundromats and car washes, a favorite of gang members, and they would launder it that way. And then once you start getting like duffel bags full of cash, that's impossible. So they would just get bankers to take the money, and even that becomes the volume is too much. So they would put it on planes and ship it right back to Colombia, so they just have the cash in Mexico. I mean, I know guys that had check cashing places, and like they would send it to Mexico, wire it to Mexico, but it just got to be too much. Like even for us to count it was just, I mean, it takes all day to count like a million. It's not even worth it. We just weigh it.
You'd weigh it.
Yeah, it's a gram a bill. So.
Oh, it's a gram a bill. Yeah. I mean, gram. I mean, I guess a dollar weighs as much as $100, but
yeah,
you're literally doing the math. If they're all $100 bills,
all 20s, yeah,
or all 20s, so, or whatever it is, it's just a gram a bill.
Yeah, and you, there's like a little bit of error, but it's not even, you kind of sit there and count it, and people are like, oh, I wish you get a money counter. Well, in the money counter in those days, you have to put it all in the right, make sure that they're all flat, like basically iron them. I did that too.
Right.
And then put them in the money counter, and then it gets all gummed up after, like, I don't know, when you do a few, and then it just doesn't work.
It was sort of like vending machines back in the day when you'd feed the dollar in and it'd spit it out, and you'd feed it in and you'd spit it out.
Right.
That's the only part of life where you'd actually attempt to give money to something and it would go, puh, feh, no, sorry, not going to have it. It was always weird. Take my money, you fucking machine. And it would spit it back out again. But the early ones, I guess they can kind of read them now, but yeah, the early ones work that way. And you're saying the money counting machines that you see in all the Scarfaces of the world, more hassle than they're worth, at least the old ones.
Yeah, well, even like Scarfaces. I mean, you have to put all the bills the right way. If you're going to go to that much trouble, I might as well just count it.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I mean? And you know,
listen, I feel the same way about the dishwasher.
Yeah,
I know this sounds weird, but it's like by the time the old lady's done scraping everything off the plate, rinsing the stuff in, why not take an extra 10 seconds, give it another wipe, the sponge, and put it in the fucking, put it on the rack.
Right.
Now you're going to bend down, load it into this thing, put it, fill it full of detergent, and then put the anti-spot, whatever, shut it up, have it run for an hour, then open it up, get hit with that big plume of, the big plume of smoke in your face, or the big thing of steam, and then you're going to backbreakingly unload the thing. Aren't we already there? We're at the sink. Are you with me on
this,
Kenji?
I've always thought that, too, with the dishwasher. If I have to scrub it down, use a brush, and scrub off everything, and then basically I'm washing it because I'm using hot water, why not just do a little bit more, put it in the rag, dry it, and then put it right away?
Another 8 seconds on each plate, and it's done. versus the hour it's going to take to go. And then, and always the controversy, at least growing up in the Corolla house, is the dishwasher, is it clean or is it dirty? Because it was always controversy because they're always out of a spork or something, you know. Is this dirty? Then you do that move where you'd open it up and you try to survey it. I don't know if it's dirty. Then you pull like one fork out and you go, this looks all right. And then you'd start using it and then you'd notice there was a plate that had shit on it. And then you'd get grossed out because you're like, oh, this wasn't. Yeah, a lot of trouble. We had, we were such losers growing up. We had the portable dishwasher. It had wheels on it. And you would wheel it over. They had these things in the 70s. Yeah. And then at some point, someone realized they'd been doing way too much coke that Kenji had been distributing. And this is the world's worst idea. Again, you have the plate in the sink. You've rinsed the plate off. Then what my mom would do was push the thing. It was on casters. Push it over to the sink. Pull a long hose out of the thing, a retractable hose.
Yep.
Clump it onto the, you know, snap it onto the end of the sink, the spigot, to get the water. Turn the hot water on. Then go back and load the thing. Run it. And then put the whole thing away just to say we had a dishwasher. But we didn't even have a fucking built-in dishwasher. Ugh. It is really, it's sort of the equivalent of the wall-mounted air conditioner versus the central air. You know you're not doing well with the wall mount. We had one room with a wall-mounted air conditioner and the mobile dishwasher. And by the way, no dryer, no clothes dryer. I forgot to always forget to add that to the list. So anyway, Kenji, you're bringing the coke in. It's coming in through Mexico at this point.
Right.
You're the guys in charge of distributing the coke.
Right.
And how do you, then what? How do you climb the ladder?
Well, I mean, I just would do that. And I broke off on my own. And since I had the access to all this coke at such a cheap price, then I had guys on the street selling it for me, my own separate clients.
Uh-huh.
And I met.
What could you get the coke for at that time? Let's just say a gram.
Oh, I don't even know. I used to get kilos, so I would buy it at like 20,000, whatever the wholesale price was at that point.
20,000 a kilo.
Yeah, a kilo. Then I'd flip it, or
the kilos, and a kilo's worth 40.
Yeah, it depends on where. Like, I had clients in Hawaii, I had them in Aspen, you know, different places, and I would.
Did you have celebrity clients?
Did I have celebrity clients back then? Not really, because I didn't really bust it up that much. I didn't honestly.
You'd give it to a guy who then gave it to a guy who then gave it to John Belushi or whoever was doing the coke.
It wasn't much. Like, I wasn't really into like being involved in that part. I was more interested in like, oh, how can I sell more quantity?
Right.
Yeah. So, but I met a lot of big guys because I traveled in that circle. So I would meet the guys in Hawaii, the guys that can move like 5 kilos at a time, and then that's basically how I did it. And then I would just start building my own little crew that way.
And is it sort of Miami Vice stuff? I mean, is that a gross exaggeration of the money? Were people pulling up in Lamborghini Countaches and wearing white jackets with no t-shirts under them and no socks?
Well, I'm guilty of the white jacket, the white pants, and the no socks. And I even had a Miami device where, you know, you kind of grow that stubble.
Yeah.
Yeah, I lived that 80s lifestyle. And I had a corrupt cop that I worked with, and he thought he was Don Johnson, and he used to dress like that, and he kind of looked like that. We used to go pick up women at the Red Onion, and
sure.
It was like Miami Vice night, and the Porsche, and the Corvette.
So you're living this lifestyle, and what do your parents think the whole time? Because you told me before that they're traditional.
They just didn't have any idea. Like, I literally just moved out, changed my name, and then I would just lie to them and say, oh, yeah, I'm working at this restaurant.
But you pull up the 930 slant nose turbo Porsche. Well, no, they didn't ask anything.
I would just ride up in a motorcycle or whatever. Mm-hmm. I'd have a work car. Like, I have a, I used to always like a Toyota 4x4 trucks. Mm-hmm. I really like those.
Uh-huh.
And so I'd have, that's my work car.
Right.
And then I would drive that around, you know, and then at night, and then I have another car.
Keep a low profile.
Yeah, that's my.
And so now when do the wheels come off the wagon in the cocaine industry for you?
Well, my friends started getting killed. And
now who was killing him?
One of my friends got killed by the Medellin cartel, like by some Colombians in Newport Beach. He was machine gunned in his Porsche, and that was on TV.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was on TV and on the radio. And
the Colombians are some of the meanest people on the planet, are they not? Are they some of the scariest, most fucked up people on the planet?
They just don't care, and they just
don't care. I think that's a good way to.
Well, you got to remember, they're coming from like an impoverished country. They may even have been like a soldier and done horrible things to other people down there, or they're just Indians like from the jungle.
Right.
So a couple $100, man, your life isn't worth much, because down there that's like, you know, 3 or 4 months worth of food.
I'm trying to think like who's meaner, like Koreans or Colombians, but I mean, there's certain breeds of people, and everyone thinks I'm a xenophobe for this, but fuck you. All you assholes. Listen, Germany, if I was going to fly in an airplane, I'd like it made in Germany and not in Mexico. But if I was going to a party, I'd like to be drinking a margarita and having me a chimichanga. That's all I'm saying. There's certain cultures do things better than other cultures. And certain cultures, by the way, are more docile. And certain cultures are mean.
Right.
And Colombians will fuck you up. And I don't think they even think about it.
No, they're mean.
Yeah, they're mean, right?
Yeah, they're tough guys.
And, I mean, part of it is being tough. The other part is, like, I don't think they care. I just think they would just shoot you and kill you and never think about it, right?
They don't care. I mean, there was one guy that had a problem with me, a guy named Ruben, and he told him, this guy that I knew, Big Mike, he said that if I see Kenji in a club with people, I don't care. I'm just going to open fire on him with a machine gun. And he doesn't care who's in the club with me. He's going to get me.
Well, first off, was it Pablo Escobar? Escobar, yeah. Was Escobar the one who blew up the commercial flight?
Yeah, he blew up Avianca Flight 103, I think, in Colombia.
Yeah, had 100 and something people in it.
To get two people?
Well, actually, the guy sent on the plane with the suitcase filled with the C4 didn't even know he was going to be. Here's what a fucking scary guy he was. He told one of his lieutenants, hey, I need you to go on this airplane. Oh, and don't forget this new briefcase I got you, which had a bomb in it. And it was just to take out a guy who was running for president or mayor or whatever.
Yeah, he was going to do something about being able to extradite them.
He took out an entire commercial flight just to get to one guy who he could have easily shot on the ground and not killed all the fucking poor people that were just trying to go see their grandkids or whatever. Also, when we're watching the movie, we're talking about the documentary when we did Loveline, the Cocaine Cowboys.
Correct.
And the woman, the Black Widow.
Yeah, Griselda Trillo Blanco. We called her, she lived in Irvine and she was around Newport Beach. We called her Mama Coca.
And she would just kill anyone at the drop of a hat, right?
Anyone. And one of my friends joked with her one time. We were out. And they said, what would you do? Because she used to have a ring that she said was owned by Evita Peron. I mean, like probably $1 million back in the 80s. And my friends just joked with her, what would you do if we just tried to take your stuff? And she smiled and she opened up her bag. And she had a gun in there.
Really?
Yeah. And I was like, I made that guy leave. I'm like, you know what? You got to leave.
Don't fuck around.
Because she had bodyguards and killers that were with her, too. And I was like, this isn't even funny.
The one of the most, and you guys can watch Cocaine Cowboys. I think I saw it on HBO or Showtime a couple of months back. But one of the craziest parts of that whole documentary, it was all crazy. But one of her enemies was coming in from Colombia and he was going to be in like the Miami International Airport or something, and she's like, I want this fucker dead. And her henchmen were like, all right, well, we'll let him land, get in the shuttle, go to his hotel, and then we'll kill him. And she was like, no, I want him killed at the airport. And everyone was like, how are we going to kill him at the airport? There's security everywhere, there's people, there's cameras. Why not just let him get into a cab and get down the road, and then we'll just pull up on a motorcycle and shoot him in the cab? She's like, no, I want him killed in the airport. I think with a machete or something.
With a bayonet.
With a bayonet. With a bayonet. In the airport. And one of those dumb fucking Colombian guys just went like, yeah, I'll do it. And like,
you got caught.
Well, of course. How are you going to get out of the airport with a bayonet?
Right. In front of everyone.
In front of everyone. Like, he was just in the terminal, right?
He walked off the plane and they just ran up and got him.
He had no escape plan, right? It's not like he had a jetpack or a helicopter waiting on the roof or anything, right?
No, that was it.
What was his plan?
I mean, I don't know. I wasn't there, but I would suspect that he thought he'd get to stab him and then run away.
So this is a potent combination of super angry and homicidal, and then fucking dumb, right? I mean, how dumb do you have to be to stab a guy in an airport?
But you have to add one more thing to that, is the vast amounts of money that they have.
Right.
And that could corrupt anyone.
And then I don't understand why Mama Coca would need him killed in the airport either, because she knows they're going to catch the guy who hits him with the bayonet. Maybe he talks. Maybe he says who ordered the...
He was too scared because of his family in Colombia.
Oh, my God.
But I'm sure she wanted to make a point, the point being that you can't set foot in Miami
and
die.
Well, I mean, she did make a point, literally, with the bayonet. I think the guy ended... Well, here's the scary thing. I think the guy ended up living, and they only gave the guy, like, attempted murder or something like that. They didn't... He never got murder. I don't know where you come down on this, Kenji, but listen. If I'm getting off an airplane and a guy comes at me with a bayonet and stabs me 17 times and miraculously through being transported to St. John's and all the work of the great surgeons over there, somehow I pull through, I want this guy to still get murder.
He should get life.
If I live... Then he gets attempted murder.
Right.
That just means he fucked up at his job.
He's horrible.
And he did a horrible job, and a surgeon did a great job. 20 years ago, I would have just bled out on the floor of the airport. Now I'm alive. But you shouldn't get a bump. Like, you shouldn't get attempted murder just because I happened to take my vitamins and was in good shape or something. You should get the death penalty, or at least murder one, because that's what you tried to do.
You went there with the intention of killing somebody.
I think this guy, by the way, didn't get murder one, because I think the guy lived, but I can't remember. But if you guys ever want to watch a documentary, watch that Cocaine Cowboy. So the Colombians are out of control. They're scary.
Oh, they're scary, guys. They're scary.
And like you said, they'll walk into a club and just start spraying it.
Yeah. They were... The guy told he told a friend of mine, another heavy guy, he said that if I see him, I'm going to spray it. And so I knew he was serious. But there was a couple other times that they were serious like that, too.
And what do you do when you hear a threat like that?
I went looking for him.
Oh, you went looking for him?
Yeah, I went looking for him. But he got taken down by the FBI not shortly after
that. So you're when a guy makes that proclamation, if I see Kenny, I'm going to spray him, then your plan is I got to find him before he finds me?
Correct, yeah, I got to go and spray him.
And when you find him, that's the plan,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I'm lighting him up.
Like, so, and how do you go about then? I mean, how do you physically go about looking for this guy?
Find out where he is, you know, where he might hang out. And unlike them, I would, like, you know, not spray him inside a restaurant. I would wait till he goes in the parking lot or get him, you know, just start doing recon, looking for him.
Right. And that happened more than once with you?
Oh, when people were looking to hurt me, yeah.
Obviously, they didn't get to you.
Obviously, they didn't get to me. I'm still here.
And what happened on each time? This guy got hit by the feds before he got to you. What?
Yeah. Other times, I might have just caught someone that was close to him, thrown him a beating. One of his crew members or something. Or what? In real life, like when you like if you're really going to kill someone or if you're really going to murder someone, you have to realize that after a couple at the heat of the passion, you're like, yeah, I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill him. And then after like a couple weeks. You realize that it's not that big of a deal. It's going to cost you so much, and it's going to be you get you in so much trouble. It's not really worth it.
Yeah,
and that's why I say like all these people that kill people. I look at them, I'm like, oh, you guys are so stupid. You ended someone's life for no reason, like over nothing. Like, oh, because you found your wife cheating with him or something. But if you would have waited like 6 months, you would have found a new girl, and it would have been the end of that anyway.
Well, they're called crimes of passion for a reason, and I know I feel the same way. Look, you hear about these stories all the time. Hey, he's a good-looking guy from Canada, and his dad's a big-time architect, and he's with some floozy from Vegas, and you know he's fucked up, and she gets back with her old. This guy's good-looking. He's rich.
He's on TV shows.
He's 30 years old. Joe Francis will be doing coke off some hooker's ass in 3 weeks somewhere, and he'll be banging his way through Hollywood in no time at all. Like, what the fuck? I mean, that's the whole point. You don't think.
Right.
You just react. And I don't know. I really wish we could screen people and figure out the people that we're going to snap and go, you know, hit the campus and start trying to kill co-eds, and the ones that just sort of were like us. We're like, well, I'd like to kill that guy, and I'd like to kill that chick, and I'd like to do a bunch of stuff, but you know what? I'll move on. And it's not killing. For me, it's writing letters. Oh, I'm going to write that guy. I'm writing that company a letter. They're going to know. Believe me, when I'm when I'm done with Southwest, they'll be begging me for an apology. How dare they treat me this way? As soon as I get back to L.A., I'm going to fire off a vitriolic email. And then you know what? I was like, fuck it. Have a glass of wine.
Too much hassle.
Too much hassle. And then what's in it for you? And again, what's in it for you? All right, so you kill the person. You kill the chick. Now you're on the lam.
Right.
You're totally fucked up. You went from good-looking, rich guy, son of the architect to, you know, hiding around in the trunk, you know, traveling in a trunk of a car. Trying to get people to sneak you back into Canada. Like, what?
Yeah, you're living in an $80 a day motel.
I'll tell you, if I was in charge, that's what I would do. Instead of this, like, you know, the freeway signs over here with the click it or ticket on, I just go murder. What's in it for you? I mean, whether you're a gangbanger who's just spraying the house and the four-year-old girl is sleeping, gets hit and dies, and now you're fleeing to Mexico and you're 19 and you're, you know.
Well, you got to remember those kind of crimes, too, is just over, like, the guy came on my street. He spray painted on the wall. It's like he wore a different color. I mean, so what, man? They're just guys like you.
They don't think so. So now, but you were the thinking man's hoodlum.
Well, I was there I'm there as a career criminal. I was there to make money. That's my job, is to make money.
What is the best year you had, in your estimation?
Dude, I had a lot of good years. All good years until.
What do you think would have been the most you raked in a year?
I always clear like $200,000 to $300,000 in cash every single year, just myself, but not counting how much I just gave away to all my friends and everyone else. Oh. Because the way you keep making money is to give your money away.
Right.
You know, spread the wealth. So right. That when you, like, if I give you money, even if it doesn't matter what you do, if I'm already taking care of you, when you come up with something, and you will, someone always does,
right,
then you'll cut me in on it.
Right.
And then I'll be there. So many times I helped out the guy who was like a janitor or something, and then like he would turn me on like, dude, just all these diamonds in here. You know what I mean? Like something would happen.
Well, when did it go from cocaine to pornography?
As the whole cocaine thing was starting to, I could see the writing on the wall that this wasn't a long-term business. Like, there was no old drug dealers. I was going to be dead. Right. Dead or in prison. So in, like, the 89, I started thinking, like, well, where could I branch out to? And my attorney introduced me to some guys that were shooting porno movies. And I could just put up cash.
An awesome attorney.
You know what I mean? Like, he's like, dude, you could just pay cash. I'm like, how much? And they're like, $60,000. So I'm like, so I just gave him $60,000 in a paper bag. I had one of my guys that worked for me, who turned out to be an attorney, which is funny.
Mm-hmm. My attorney, I think we have different attorneys, because my attorney, Andy, recently got off a cruise with his mother. So it's probably a different guy than the guy who told you to go into pornography.
Correct.
All right. So, Jewish guy, lanky?
Yeah, he was.
Well, maybe it was the same dude.
Yeah,
but. So, what a mistake telling me and Jimmy just got off a cruise with your mom. But so you want to get into pornography, you get $60,000, you put it in a bag, and what do you do with it?
I just gave it to my friend who also became an attorney, but he wasn't one at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, go check this out, and you know, how much? And then I asked the guy, how much money do I get back? They're like, oh, you can make $30,000. I'm like, do it.
Right.
And so we did it, and then they had a little problem selling the movie, and then that's how I got more involved in it, and I started to see, and then I sold it right away. And
who do you sell it to? I mean, you have the porno movie?
Yeah, I shot the porno movie.
Who was in it? Was anyone we know?
Oh, yeah. Well, back then would be, like, I think Samantha Strong was in it.
Sure.
Lois Ayers.
Yeah.
Peter North was in there.
Can't make a movie without Peter North.
This guy, Cal Jammer, and John Doe.
I know Cal Jammer and John Doe, sadly.
Yeah.
And Lois Ayers. Yeah, I could never really figure her name out. Her and Ebony Eyes were the two ones. Whenever I read it, I'd always mispronounce it. But Samantha Strong, who I can't remember. Blonde, right?
Yep, yeah. Blonde, yeah.
Yeah. I kind of like Samantha. Find Samantha Strong. I think I liked her.
She was cute back in the day.
Yeah. I had a weird porn dilemma the other day. I got to think of the chick's name, but Donnie, you may want to weigh in on this. Kenji, you tell me. There was I'll think of her name before the podcast is through, but somehow, you know, this old porn chick's name came up, and I was thinking, man, this chick was hot. I remember she was a really hot blonde. And so I was like, huh. And then I like Googled her, and then I found out that she committed suicide in 1984. And then I thought,
Shauna Grant?
It was Shauna Grant, actually. Thank you. Shauna Grant was a piping hot blonde. I mean, really just cute. Didn't look porny or anything. No tats, no piercings, no shave this and all that stuff. And Shauna Grant was just a hot-looking, just a hot-looking blonde. And I was like, I was always like, God, yeah, I remember seeing her in a few movies. She's really hot. And then she killed herself in I think it was 84. And then I had that moral dilemma. Is it okay to beat off to somebody who killed themselves? And then I thought, well, you can't do it, you know, that if they killed themselves that afternoon. But I mean, you know, 20 years, 25 years gone by now, and maybe that's the way she would have wanted it. You know, I mean, never really think of it that way, you know. It turns out I didn't, but I remember having a little dilemma. I remember, but Shauna Grant was hot. But now you started your porn career a little bit after her, a little bit after she killed herself,
correct.
Right?
Yeah, correct.
So, Donnie, Shauna Grant, am I right? Yeah. I think, I don't know what movie I had that she was in it. But anyway, so everyone is in your movie. Now, and what, do you remember what it was called? Do you remember what the theme was? Would it have 8 different titles?
Yeah, but I think one of them became like Haunted Passions or something like that. Uh-huh. Yeah, like, you know.
Were you on the set when they were filming?
On that one, I didn't even bother to go because I could care less. It didn't interest me at that point. I just cared about how much money I was going to get
now
back.
How much would you pay the actors and the actresses? And how did it work? I'm always curious. I mean, now I know Jenna Jameson's an entrepreneur now and all that kind of stuff. But back in the day, you're literally just getting paid you're doing piecework. I mean, you're getting paid per scene or per movie. These aren't contract players anymore.
Well, even today, the big misconception is that these people make a ton of money in it. They don't. I mean, the girls really get paid piece of work. Even the girls that work as contract girls for these big companies, they make like $60,000 to $80,000 a year contract. Big deal, man, to risk your life like that. But they get money to go out feature dancing, and then
right.
And then they make their big money being an escort, which I don't know, they all say they
oh,
don't.
Oh, really?
But they all do.
Oh,
big time.
Oh, now this is interesting. That's
in my book. I was with them.
They don't make that much money. So, I mean, it's like, okay, you're not going to make that much money doing this movie. But when you hit the road, everyone's going to know Christy Canyon's name or right. Shauna Grant's name or whoever. And by the way, there's some crazy Arab dude who'll pay $50,000 to be with Christy Canyon for one
right.
night.
Correct.
And that's where you make your money.
That's where you make your
radio's
money.
The same way, actually. They don't actually pay, but they're like, you can definitely sell some hats and shit if you get on our station. All right, so how much would these women get paid per scene back in the day?
I believe I paid around $400 or $500 a scene.
And even if they were a big name?
Yeah, that was a big name. I might pay like $800 if they were a big name.
Uh-huh. And then you said they all denied, but they got paid as escorts. I mean, that's where they made the real money.
I mean, later on, I went on the road with all of them. I worked with one of the biggest madams ever. She's being prosecuted right now for it. Nikki's Girls is the name of her company that she owned, and I work with Exotica 2000 who book girls, and they used to book them like $10,000 a night.
And I know they all deny it because you're dancers and you're porno stars, but you're not whores. You know what I mean? Like, what the fuck difference does it make whether Peter North or Ron Jeremy's on top of you or some Japanese businessman? I mean, who the hell cares?
It is behind closed doors. I mean, it's like, to me, I always thought it was kind of, it was funny because, like, here you'll do it on film, but you don't want anyone to know that you're getting paid $10,000 in a hotel room for 45
right.
minutes.
But that was true. So there's a lot of guys who are like, I'm rich and I want to say I was with fill in the blank.
So many guys, because you can
fill in the blank would be a good porn name, actually.
Right. you could like look online. It was like a catalog, and you can literally pick like a Playboy Playmate. You could pick a adult actress, a penthouse pet, or magazine girl. I mean, anything.
There's this whole world that I hear about every once in a while, and I even hear about it as it pertains to celebrities and top models. I'm talking about females who, like, go, look, this person who you might know from TV or might be, you know, a news anchor or something, this young hot chick, you know, used to for $100,000 a pop would give you a pop. I would love to know, I don't know why, but I would love to know what celebrities, like what names. Like, you know, the porn stars have done it, but I bet you there's a handful of Tyra Bankses of the world or something who have done this kind of activity too. Not saying Tyra has, just saying in that, you know, whatever that famous chick who you kind of remember from that sitcom or from that talk show. I wonder how many of them have done this kind of shit.
I think more than you would
say. More than I know?
I know a few. I just can't say it, but I actually know.
Really?
Yeah, I actually know.
Like TV stars.
I know someone that's a movie star now that did it.
Yeah. Man. Is she married to Antonio Banderas?
No. But she's married to like a billionaire. So.
But I mean, it's like you know a few names of movie stars who you'd be like, we would all know the name of.
No, without a doubt.
And you know for a fact that they were super high class prostitutes.
Correct.
I guess.
Yeah.
And how do you know that?
Because one, I saw the records. Two, I would see they had like a VIP section of like super, like where you had to pay like $100,000 to become a VIP member, and you get access to the girls where they're blocked from the general public. But I used to see those girls, and so I knew who they were.
And at this point in their career, they were actresses, but not big name actresses.
Correct. Or you're going to live in the Hollywood lifestyle, but you can't afford to,
right,
drive a nice car. But you need new clothes every time you go on the red carpet, so you got to get it somehow.
Wow, that is titillating to me. And then, of course, then all the porn chicks who would go out and do it. Now, what would the guys get paid versus the women?
Oh, you mean on the sets?
Yeah,
like a couple $100, $200. Really cheap.
So I mean, it's like Peter North would just get $200 a scene. That was it.
At that point, yeah, $200, $250.
And then how would the guys make any money? Because you couldn't go out and dance, really.
Most of them were like drug dealers on the side back in the day.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Like, I know a lot of them that are successful now that used to, like, one who's really successful now has a big company. I won't say his name, but he was a big pot dealer at that point.
I'm going to go with Paul. What the hell is his name? Paul.
Not Paul Little.
No, that's a horrible porn name.
No, that's Max Hardcore. But,
yeah. I'm trying to think of, who's the guy that does all the porn directing now? Paul?
I know who you're talking about. Paul Thomas.
Paul Thomas.
It's not Paul Thomas. No. I mean, he comes from a rich family, but.
Oh. I miss Bobby Hollander, by the way.
Oh, Bobby was my friend, man.
Bobby Hollander, Donnie. I have no idea who Bobby Hollander is, but Donnie had this video that was like up-and-comers for 1984, and he'd just be sitting there like, "Hi, I'm Bobby Hollander. You know, today we feature some starlets on today's show that are big into the big A, and that ain't for, I don't stand for Aqueduct." Remember that guy? I was like, who is this douchebag? But Bobby Hollander was a friend of yours?
Oh, man, Bobby was a good friend of mine.
Who was he?
He was just he was a guy who knew everyone, a connected guy. He was in pornography like for 30 years before.
Back when they were just cave drawings?
Yeah, before I even got in there. But he always would come up with great concepts. And the guy was like constantly betting and on drugs. It was great. He lost a lug. He had cancer. And he was like, I have to tell you, I went to a wake.
He seemed like a mess, guy.
Here's the best thing. He was dying.
Mm-hmm.
And he knew he was going to die. So he had a wake when he was still alive. And we had a big party for him. And he was there. And he asked me, he goes, "Hey, could you bring me an 8-ball? And I'm like, "Man." And he's like, "Dude, I'm going to fucking die anyway." And I'm like, "That's what you really
what
want?"
What year is this?
Oh, this is in the 90s, sometime in the 90s. And I'm like, "Listen."
So he knows he's dying.
Yeah.
He says terminal cancer.
Definitely dead.
He's going to be dead in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And he says, "I'm throwing a wake while I'm still alive.
Correct.
I'm going to enjoy it.
Right.
And I want you to bring me an 8-ball.
Yeah. So I was like, so I asked one of his friends. I'm like, "Do you think it's okay?" And they're like, "Yeah, go ahead." So then.
One of his friends.
Right. So then wait. So then I did. And then
Dick Rambone, by the way, was one of his friends. He probably asked.
Then I spoke to another person. Yeah, there he is, right there. It's on my thing.
Mm-hmm.
Then I spoke to another person, and I found out that he got one from them too. So he got it from a whole bunch of different people, not just me.
Bobby Hollander. Oh, it's a different. It was a different era in porn back then. So the guys would get a couple $100 a pop and have to pretty much deal drugs.
Yeah.
Chicks would get $300-$500, but then they would go on the road and they'd all do the escort stuff.
Correct.
And I'm guessing they probably were with a lot of, you know, the Charlie Sheens of the world and that kind of stuff, right? I mean, that's pretty common knowledge.
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah. I mean, my ex-wife was with Charlie. Not that she's a bad person because I'm good friends with her still, but.
Who was your ex-wife?
I was married to Tabitha Stevens.
Oh, yeah. Liked her. She was hot and, like I said, named named after the kid from Bewitched.
Correct.
And so now you're going down the porn highway. Now, how much money is there to make in the porn world?
Well, I figured out a way that I could take my friend's drug money, like the cash money that they used to get, and then I would shoot the movies with the drug money, the cash, and they'd all want to do it because, oh, yeah, I'm back in a porno movie.
Right.
And then I would get a check back for it.
How much was it? How much was the average budget for one of these movies in the late 80s, something like that?
Well, it depends if we did a video or if we did shot on film, and I did both. So, like, videos would cost around $15,000, and, film would be about $60,000.
So, obviously, video cheaper. And then that's back when they would be, a lot of the money would come from renting the movies?
Well, also, mail order was huge back then because people... They still had adult bookstores, but they were like CD places and everything else. And like, you know, your normal video store really wasn't into the adult yet. So we could sell some of the mail order things, we used to sell like $49.99 for Deep Throat. I mean, it was incredible.
$49.99,
man, for a tape.
I could remember, you probably didn't care because you made your money easily moving the coke and the broads and everything. But I remember once in a blue moon, you'd rent a movie. And you just rent like Mannequin 2 or Weekend at Bernie's or something. And then one of your douchebag buddies would lose the tape or something. And you'd go back to the video store and they'd be like, $118. And you'd be like, for what? I can't remember, Donnie. It happened to one of us in one movie, I think, that Chris rented. But, I mean, literally, not only was it a shitty movie, but it had been run and cycled 200,000 times. Just the notion that you could sell a videotape for $50 now. So you're making money hand over fist doing that?
Yeah, it was good.
And where's it now? I mean, obviously, the market for buying and renting, it's all internet now, right?
Well, yeah. It's way oversaturated, too. It's kind of like the cocaine market. Just so many people are doing it. You have so many websites that you can go to. You could download free porn just like music.
Right, I mean, you couldn't make money like you did now with YouPorn and stuff out there, right?
No, you can't. It's not the same. It's not the same. Look at it. It's out everywhere.
Right. So, what is organized crime into these days?
Well, back then, they controlled all the distribution of the pornography, the printing, a bunch of other stuff. And so that's how I already knew a lot of guys, via my lawyer or through the cocaine game. I knew guys involved in the L.A. mob family.
Was that all did it start in North Hollywood?
Dude, Porn Valley, man, that's it.
I went to North Hollywood High, and I swear to God, half the chicks we went to high school with ended up getting into the porn business. But then it seemed to migrate out to the West Valley at a certain point, like Chatsworth and Canoga Park and that area. But North Hollywood, my hometown, really is...
was the original place.
They ought to put that on the rotary sign out, now entering, like they'll do like if you go to DeKalb, Illinois, they'll tell you, oh, we invented barbed wire and Cindy Crawford was born here. North Hollywood doesn't have a lot going for it. I think Amelia Earhart lived there for like 10 minutes or something like that. But at least work porn into it. So now, Donnie, stop putting porn up on the screen. I can't work with a boner. I'm trying to conduct an interview here. So now, at a certain point, when do the feds close in? When do you start talking? How does it work?
Well, back then I worked with a corrupt cop, and I learned real soon that everyone who's successful, because it wasn't just me. I mean, guys that are on a bigger scale, when you're successful, they all inform. They do it. They give up something to get something. Mm-hmm. It's intelligence. If you're smart, you're gonna do something like that. They didn't. When I finally decided to flip, I just kept doing this. Like I said, I did the porn. I did bookmaking. I was just a criminal, so I was doing stuff all the time. In the late 90s, they came to me, and I was already involved with the LCN, and they came to me and they said that...
What's the LCN?
La Cosa Nostra.
I thought that was more. I thought that was the Mormon church.
No.
Okay.
And so I was already involved with them, and they came to me, and they left a message with Tabitha's grandmother, and I was like...
That's nice.
Yeah, I know, but I'm like, why would they do this, man? They know how to get a hold of me. They know my name.
How pissed was Tabitha's grandmother that her granddaughter was in porn and dating a guy who was dealing dope and doing...
The FBI, the Organized Crime Squad, is coming looking for me.
How pissed off was she as a grandparent? Like, a lot of grandparents get pissed off when their kid goes to junior college. Imagine this.
It's a failure.
Yeah. Did her grandma know what was going on?
Well, she knew that the organized crime squad came because they showed their badges and they left their cars.
Right.
So that was in Vegas, and then they wrote me back, or they called me back. I called them, and they called me back, and then they told me they were going to meet me in Costa Mesa at this deli. And so I was away on a trip back east, and so when I got back, I figured, I'm just going to go to prison, so I'm going to get locked up for something. So I gave Tabitha all my money, emptied my pockets, took my watch off, wore some sweats because I figured I might be in jail for a couple of days. Might as well be comfortable.
Right.
And I got to this deli, and there was like three agents met me outside, and they asked me, "Hey, do you have a gun?" Or, no, I'm like, "No, I don't have anything. I don't even have a cell phone on me." So they searched me. When I went in the back, and there was just all agents. There must have been like eight or nine, and I sat in the booth with them. They searched me, and then they said, "Look, we have you on like this real small insurance fraud thing." And you might get off, you might get like a year and a day, it's not a big deal, but we're gonna get you, you're gonna go down for RICO, we're gonna get you for a life in prison, or you're gonna get killed on the street. Mm-hmm. And they're like, and I'm like, okay, so what? And they're like, well, we could offer you something else. And I'm like, what? And they're like, a new start, a fresh start.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, at that point I think I was about 28 or 29, and I thought, man, or maybe I was 30, and I'm like, I'm such a loser. Like, I had all the material things I wanted, but I just didn't have, like, a real life. Like, I'm married to a porn star who, like I said, she's a cool girl, but just not where you want to be. When all my friends have houses and kids and, you know, dogs and...
Right.
Yeah, and I'm flying around to Miami because the sun's there, you know?
Right.
It just wasn't good. So I said, a fresh start, and they said, yeah. And I said, okay, I'll do it. And they said, you don't want to talk to the lawyer? And I'm like, oh, I don't even trust him. No way. So...
That's a guy who got you in the porn.
Well, this is a different one. He was even worse. This lawyer was even worse than that one. So they offered me the deal, and they said, but I said, oh, there's some people I don't want. They're like, we're not even interested in those people. All we want you to do is gather intelligence for us. Once in a while, we'll wire you up. You're not going to come out. So I said, okay. And then I asked, how long do you think it'll last? And he said, oh, about 6 months, maybe a year. And I'm like, okay, I can live with that.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, that went on for 8 years.
8 years. And how many times did you wear the wire?
I mean, I lived in Brooklyn, New York, and just in Brooklyn alone, I wore a wire like maybe 300 or 400 times.
Really?
Yeah, 300 or 400 hours.
Was it freaky, like in movies, when you're wearing the wire? Didn't bother you?
Well, actually, because it's not even a wire. It's not a wire at all. It's actually one of them was like a coin, like a 50-cent piece, and there's no moving parts. There's no lights on it. You have to get a little paperclip, and you click it. You press it on a certain spot, and it clicks, and that's how you know it came on. And that's it. And it runs straight for 9 to 13 hours. And then I had...
Really?
Yeah, I had another one that was like a little square, and I put it right here in a pocket. And yeah, in a watch.
Would they tell you, look, start asking these questions or don't ask that?
No, because this is the thing. Like, I knew what they kind of wanted, but you could never... You never, like in that group of people, and especially like in the mafia, you never ask a question. Everyone will tell you anyway.
Right.
You never have to answer. You just have to sit there.
Right.
They'll get it out. But if you start asking questions, then when they get busted, they might get busted for something that had nothing to do with you. You'll get blamed for it because you knew it. You asked.
Uh-huh. So, it's interesting. Yeah.
This is what I do. I just turn it on, and I just let whatever happened unfold.
Mm-hmm.
And it would.
And then you would go back in, and they would collect it, and they'd send you. And that was 8 years of that.
Well, yeah. Like in Brooklyn, it was so dangerous there that we just I do like a brush pass. Like, they'd have a car window open, and I would take the old one. Because as soon as I'm done, I would take it and throw it in the car. The two of them in the car. I used to always wear two, so if one failed, then the other one would work.
Mm-hmm.
And then someone would, like, I'd go jogging, or I'd go to the bagel store, and then someone would just like slip it in my pocket, the new one.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and it was a 24-hour thing. I always had one. I always had a new one.
For 8 years.
For 8 years, man. It was like a crazy, like, double life. It was like...
Now that was from what year to what year?
I think it was like 1990 or like 1997 until 2005, like right around there.
And how do they know it's time to cut you loose? Did you tell them, look, you said it was going to be 6 months, it's 8 years now?
No, I was really, really burned out on it anyway. And like a guy in the Colombo family ended up, he kind of like started crap with me, and I just didn't care anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And so he's an older guy, well-respected, and we had a big meeting at the end, and I told him, kind of, just go fuck yourself. And he says it. He said he was going to punch me in the face. I said, well, then I'll just knock you out.
Right.
And then, you know, that's like a no-no, like standing up. Like, and then they tried to pull me into a car, and I wouldn't go. And I flew to Canada to work with some girls, you know, took some of the porn girls up there. And I was in Toronto, and the guy called me, and he wanted to know where I was, and I told him to go fuck himself. And the FBI called me and told me that those guys are going to kill me. And so that was it. I never went back. I never even got my stuff from my house.
Do you ever get a piece of paper from the FBI that says you've completed informant school and you can no longer be busted? Do you know?
I went and I signed this deal with the U.S. attorney. I did get a piece of paper that says that I fulfill my obligation. I'm like, well, 8 years?
Yeah. Well, keep in your wallet in case you get pulled over, because if the Glendale PD pulls you over, you may go in. Kenny Kenji Gallo, our guest, Breakshot, the name of the book. Kenny, sir, we're out of time, but let's do it again.
Definitely.
I always like talking to Kenny, and I feel like we've just barely scratched the surface of your illustrious criminal career. So until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Kenny Gallo saying mahalo.
Follow Adam Carolla on Twitter at Adam Carolla. Reach him via Skype at Adam Podcast or through the mail at Adam Carolla Podcast, 10061 Riverside Drive, number 276, Toluca Lake, California, 91602.